Gives me great pleasure to welcome Carolyn Leckie, who is a member of the Scottish Socialist Party, former member of the Scottish Parliament, grew up in Glasgow, daughter of a shipyard worker, now lives in East Kilbride. Before she became an MSP, she was a midwife and a local union leader who represented thousands of hospital workers and is now currently a leader activist in one of the most important groups who are in favour of independence, Women for Independence. Please welcome Carolyn Leckie.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I'm really feeling as if I've arrived. I've got a Labour sign in front of me. That's the first time ever in my entire life. And a wee bit by accident, you know, I started supporting independence when I was about 11, but I was always left-wing and I was always causing a bit of a fuss about women's rights and equality and all the rest of it. I ran after my dad, who ran a Rangers supporters bus and only allowed men on it and demanded the right to be on it when the Sex Discrimination Act came in. I never got on, my ma was mortified. But so I always had a complex political background, and I never really wanted to join any political party because it wasn't quite what I believed in. But sometimes you end up places by accident. And when I first started my first full-time job, which was a full-time job and not a YTS because it actually was the trade union in Glasgow City Chambers in Cochrane Street. When I was about 17, I joined NALGO. And I became a shop steward within a few months because I've always had a wee bit of a big mouth. And so then I was introduced to the strange world of trade union and left-wing politics. And I had absolutely no idea what was going on. And this is important for where I am today, because this is quite a good, I'm really enjoying this moment in my life. Because when I was 17, you're just looking for people who'll be your pals. And so I would go along to an Algo branch meeting, and there was a guy there who was really nice to me, he was dead friendly, his name was Colin Turbitt. And at that time, he was a member of the SWP. But he was pally. And because I sat down with him and went for my tea and coffee at the branch meetings with Colin, that was it. You were running with the trots. And I never had a clue what was going on. So Militant hated me because my pal was in the SWP. And the Labour Party people weren't very happy with me either. But it took me a wee while to work out that that's what it was. I only thought I had a pal. So I never joined any political parties then, and then I had my veins and all the rest of it. And there's a long story, I'm not getting into that. And then I qualified as a midwife about a year and a half after I qualified as a midwife. My nature got the better of me again, and again I became a shop steward in Rutherglen Maternity Hospital, which was threatened with closure, and there was a lot of reorganisations going on and all that at the time. So I joined, I was in Unison as it was then, and I became a shop steward again, got involved in all the rest of it, then became active in the branch, became a delegate to Unison National Conference, went along and again had an unfortunate pal. This time my pal was Charlie McCarthy, I don't know if you know him. He was in the Militant at the time, or what was the Militant, Scottish Militant Labour, who were involved in establishing the Scottish Socialist Party. So I was quite pally with him. And then I found myself at the National Conference agreeing with most of the motions that he happened to be supporting, and agreeing with quite a lot of the motions that people who were the trots were supporting. So that was it. I was running to the trots again. So eventually, I suppose, I thought, I might as well join them. So I did join the Scottish Socialist Party, but I've never been involved in or the number of various sects that appeared in the left over many years, unlike my pal Colin. He was in the SWP at that time when I was 17. I think he's been in every Monty Python sect that there's been on the left. And I ended up meeting him again in the Scottish Socialist Party all the years later, after he'd been through I don't know how many. So that was quite good. So, but I always agreed with people, and I didn't understand why, when you agreed with people, whether it was in women, equality, socialism, left, whether it was independence, why you couldn't have discussions across the whole spectrum. And I do think that independence, and even just the process of the discussion on independence, is an opportunity to do things a bit different. Because I think people are fed up with being told what to think from the top down, whatever party they're in. They are absolutely fed up with voting for one thing and getting something that's the complete opposite. They're absolutely fed up with not actually having democratic control, whether it's over your country or your organisation or your political party that you're involved in. So there's a lot of commonalities. In terms of demanding independence, Women for Independence is about independence for Scotland, also independence for women, but independence for human beings. The right to be autonomous, the right to make your own decisions, the right to take control and have control and keep control and not have it dictated to you by a power that you have absolutely no way of holding to account. And in terms of the Labour Party, I'm really privileged to be asked to be here, and I thought, better do a bit of work. Sometimes I'm running into these things and I'm talking off the top of my head, which I've just done for the first 5 minutes, but I did do a wee bit of work, and I'm sure people here who are Labour supporters or Labour members might know all this stuff. But it really annoys me when I hear people like George Fulkes, for example, whose cage was a wee bit rattled the day, I think, about this event on Twitter. Don't know if anybody's seen him. He was getting a wee bit... Are there any actual Labour members at this? Are there?
Yes,
exactly. He was really, really... But it makes me really angry, as if Labour members or voters who might even consider voting independence are somehow treacherous. That somehow it's an aberration that the Labour Party would never support independence. Absolute nonsense. The people who are actually standing in the tradition of real Labour Party values are the people in this room tonight supporting independence. And that tradition of supporting independence and a left-wing basis goes way back to the 19th century and with the establishment of the Labour Party by James Keir Hardie. He stood in 1988 in a mid-Lanarkshire by-election and had some key policies in that by-election. One was an 8-hour day. It was 12 hours shifts in the health service, and I think that's been brought back a wee bit. Health and safety legislation and tighter regulation in the mines. Women's suffrage and political rights. An end to apartheid in South Africa, freedom for India, and home rule for Scotland. A diluted version of that got delivered 111 years later. In the 1920s, the Independent Labour Party, which at that time was the biggest component of the Labour Party in Scotland, wasn't a separate party until the 30s. Organised an annual march and rally through Stirling to commemorate Bannockburn. Now, I'm no into commemorating violence of any shape or description, but I think it's quite illustrative, the idea that the sort of brave heart mentality and all the rest of it has the colour of the SNP, and it's got absolutely nothing to do with ordinary working class Scots or Labour Party voters or Labour Party members. Is absolute rubbish. Jimmy Maxton and Tom Johnson addressed rallies in Elderslie to commemorate William Wallace. When the Red Clydesiders were elected in 1922, a quarter of a million people turned up to greet them as they boarded the train to London. They sang songs to say cheerio to them, such as "A Man's a Man" for all that. I'm hitting the women there, I have to say. Scots Wahae, which is one that a lot of people feel uncomfortable with, myself included, but that's what they were singing, as well as the red flag and the Internationale, demonstrating that autonomy, independence and internationalism are actually very easy bedfellows. In fact, Tom Henderson, MP, I'd never really heard of him until I looked at this today. Has anybody heard of him? No? Tom Henderson, MP, urged colleagues who were boarding that train, not to board the train, to spurn Westminster and establish a government in Scotland in the old Scottish Parliament. So there was a strong, strong presence of independent support and Labour activists, founders and members who associated their struggle for equality and emancipation and revolution with the very demand for independence. They did go. He didn't get his way. But the first thing they did was laid down a bill for an independent Scotland within a federal Britain. It was supported by every single Labour MP, but was talked out by the Tories. That is the Labour Party in Scotland's history. Now, things might have changed a wee bit after the Second World War, when perhaps there was a greater sense of Britishness and the welfare state and I, Bevan and all the rest of it. But the truth is that the seeds of a public healthcare system, for example, were already laid in Scotland. The initiation of the NHS was actually in the Highlands and Islands. There was already the basis for an NHS in Scotland before the British state established the National Health Service. The traditions were already there, the commitment was already there, the principles were already there, and indeed Scotland, as it is today, was at the forefront of progressive politics. And the Scottish Home Rule Association that was established around that time, there were 150 trade union branches of it. There were 60 cooperative branch sections in it, 50 Labour Party branches in it, and 29 Scottish Labour and Liberal MPs in it. So this here today is not a deviation, it's continuity. And it's picking up the principles, the traditions, the history and the values of the very people that they look up to as the establishers of the Labour Party. And that, I have to say, would be a Labour Party that I would be proud to be a member of. So, that's me not speaking as Women for Independence. By the way, I should have explained that Women for Independence is a broad organisation of women that's about listening to women, making sure women's voices will be heard in this independence debate. We are 52% of the population. We are not an add-on. We will not be excluded for the telly. We will not be excluded for the streets. We will be heard. And actually, there are more undecided women than undecided men. And women are the key to delivering a yes vote. So ignore us at your peril. It's a meeting for independence, it's a meeting for democracy, it's a meeting for democratic revival, it's a meeting for inclusion, it's a meeting about saying everything that's happened over the last 30, 40 years isn't good enough anymore, and we're not putting up with it. And the people, not political elites, not governments, not multinational corporations, the people will decide the future of Scotland. To be able to do that, we need to have the confidence to do it. In fact, there is absolutely no evidence to suggest that Scotland can. It's nonsense. Why would Scotland be any different from any country in the whole world in being able to look after its own affairs? We're told we're too poor, we're too wee. We're actually not that wee. There's no point. It really astounds me that people think Scotland is physically a wee country. It's no. We're bigger than Denmark. We're actually one of the bigger countries in Europe. And although we've got 1/10 of the population of the UK, we have 1/3 of the landmass. Land is a huge resource. For me, that's a big constitutional issue about who owns that land. But we have fertile, rich resources, 1/3 of the landmass of the UK. There is absolutely no way that we do not have the resources, not only to be independent, but to be prosperous and to be a more equal country than that we have any chance of being tied to the UK Westminster state. But we need to have the confidence, and everybody knows we'll need to have the confidence, and this independence referendum won't be won in the mainstream media. It's very, very difficult. It's really stacked against us. It's quite biased. And actually, some research by Yes Scotland has shown that that is the case. So be confident that your grassroots campaigning, you're talking to your neighbours, you're listening to women, getting women around, everybody talking to each other. People say they are more likely to be persuaded by a member of their family, a friend, a neighbour, a colleague. So it's not going to happen through the telly or the papers. It is going to happen by people like you in this room persuading somebody else and somebody else and somebody else, and that will be enough. And I do think confidence has got something to do with it. And Dennis knows this. I talk about going to Vancouver. Has anybody ever been in Vancouver, Canada, at all? Well, it's a very optimistic place. And I thought I was quite optimistic. Some people think I'm a bit of a stupid idealist and all the rest of it. I thought I was an optimist until I went to Vancouver. And you realise that actually our psyche is really quite put down. Do you know, we're really quite like that. And if you say to somebody here, how are you? They'll say, no bad. I could be worse. I'm doing all right. I fair middling. If you say to somebody in Vancouver, how are you? They'll say, I'm great. How are you? And it's all up there. And it's the big smiles and your jaws are absolutely aching. Because you've got to keep smiling all the time. It's all so positive. And I thought, my God, this is absolutely amazing. I was there the first time for a fortnight and I came back and my jaw was killing me. Because you get socialised in it and it just shows you that a different atmosphere. And by the way, British Columbia, where Vancouver is, their provincial government has far more powers than the Scottish Parliament. Like US states, like the Faroe Islands, like the Isle of Man, they've got more powers than the Scottish Parliament. And for me, that autonomy reflects in their culture because they do feel more control. They do feel more confident about their ability to control their future. But I have to say, when I came back off the plane after traveling for 2 weeks and going, how are you? I thought, oh, that's great, I could relax as well. My face fell back down again and I thought, oh, great, I can feel like myself again. Illustrate for me that there is a confidence issue, there is a psyche issue, there is no factual basis for Scotland not being able to be independent. The only thing holding us back, as Alan says, is us being, having the ability to put across on a ballot paper and having the confidence and the hope to deny all the fear tactics and all the rest of it, and having the confidence and optimism and hope and principles and values just to put that across in the ballot paper. So the only thing stopping us